Today we're doing another pointless comparison. The baby of the RTX range versus the raid boss. To answer the age-old question, how much more gaming power do the oligarchs wield? But before that, it's time for a word from today's video sponsor. Today's video is sponsored by Corsair and their new K70 Pro RGB. Now, in my opinion, the main upgrades to this new version of the K70 is that it now comes with double shot PBT keycaps as standard, which is awesome, and the cable is now detachable, terminating in a Type-C connector on the keyboard, which is very good. There's also a bunch of RGB stuff, for those of you that care. Now, this keyboard is available in a large selection of Cherry MX switches. This one has Cherry MX RGB speed silvers in them that sound like this. If this sounds good to you, use the link in my description below to check out the new Corsair K70 Pro RGB. On paper, the difference between the two GPUs is significant. The RTX 3090 Ti is a behemoth GPU with the kind of numbers that sound like something shouted by a 12-year-old to one of their friends. Although, the two differences I find the most impressive are the price and the TDP. I mean, whoa. Physically, the two graphics cards are a relatively similar size, if you don't take into account the 360mm radiator glued to the 3090 Ti. Although, when you compare their nudes, you can see there is a lot more going on the more expensive graphics card, as you'd hope, right? That kinda seems about right. But none of this really matters. We're all here to see a big graphics card beat up a small graphics card, so let's drop them in a testbed and see how it goes at two very different resolutions. Okay, so this seems to be running at pretty much the optimal GTA 5 frame rate. The frame rate seems to be just under that point where GTA's engine starts having seizures. So this is about as good a 1080p gaming experience as you can have in this game before the stutters seep in, which that's pretty cool. Next, we have Battlefield 5 running at 1080p Ultra settings, and this is a great gaming experience. I think if you ran at 1080p High settings, which is a lot more reasonable, it would be even better. But even with more stuff going on in the scene, it still stays close to 100 frames per second. So this is good. Okay, so at 1080p High settings, with the 3050, we have a very usable gaming experience. We're not quite at 60 frames per second, but it's fine. The game feels good and it looks all pretty and stuff. And if you want a slightly higher frame rate, you can just drop the settings a little bit. So this is not too bad. In terms of the temperatures on this little Eagle card, they land squarely in the meh territory. Although, at least it's not a howler monkey, so that's good. But I think with that, it's time to drop in something a bit more beefy in this testbed. GTA 5 at 1080p with a graphics card that probably wipes itself with 1080p. Yeah, let's see what happens. Oh, stutters is what's gonna happen because the graphics card is too much for the engine to handle. We did do this in a previous video, so I'm not gonna sit on this too long. But as you can see, this is not, it's just, no. Wow, it is using a whole lot more power than the RTX 3050, I can tell you that. But it's also much faster. We are well over 200 frames per second here, and it's, yeah, this is crazy. I've not seen Battlefield 5 run like this. Granted, I have only recently figured out how to unlock the frame rate, so that also makes a difference. Last time, we tried to run it at Psycho settings on the 3090 Ti, and it didn't go super well. But let's see how it goes this time. Oh, considerably better. Okay. That is by far the highest frame rate I've ever seen in Cyberpunk. And actually, Cyberpunk does seem to scale relatively well at 1080p, because we are pretty much getting the full GPU utilization, which is not something you can say for a lot of the other games. But that's pretty cool. That is a very high frame rate. But again, all I can say is that I am very happy that we have 24 gigs of GDDR6X in this GPU, because We've clearly been using it. On the note of really using it, let's have a look at the benchmarks. Clearly, the RTX 3090 Ti is a lot faster than the 3050, but the performance results were still a bit of a mixed bag, which makes sense, considering that in a lot of cases, the GPU isn't even almost the bottleneck. And this just shows again, if you buy one of these high-end graphics cards in 2022, but you still own a 1080p display, you should probably stick some bamboo under your fingernails as punishment for your wasteful ways. Having said that, let's move over from the RTX 3050's wheelhouse and step into the 3090's domain, 4K. We're getting a pretty stable 60-ish frames per second at 4K, very high settings in GTA 5 with the RTX 3050, which, it's not too bad. It's pretty good. Whoa, I'm actually pretty surprised at how well this GPU handles 4K. This is ultra settings, and it's not a complete slideshow. It's not a great performance, but A, you shouldn't be running it at ultra, and this is not a GPU that you would reasonably expect to use at 4K. So, yeah, it's pretty impressive, little 3050. Ah, now this is a lot more in line with what I was expecting 4K to look like on the little RTX 3050. Although, again, considering that this is high settings on Cyberpunk, it's not a completely embarrassing showing. Like, this is fine. But let's drop Big Daddy back in and see how it handles itself in its own backyard. Oh, damn. Okay, well, at 4K, we're getting about the same frame rate we did at 1080p with this graphics card, which, that's pretty crazy. It means that we still get the stutters, which is nice. It really adds to the GTA 5 experience at this point. And, yeah, that's pretty crazy. Holy crap, look at that power draw. That is insane. And then you look next to it and the temps are still just 50. That is, and it's not making any noise either. That is a pretty crazy cooling solution. And aside from that, I am pretty sure that this average is considerably higher than the 3050's 1080p result. I feel like this kind of power draw for half an hour is going to set fire to the oxygen in the room. Like, that is, that's madness. Oh, well, I may have some crazy power at my disposal, but it clearly doesn't help me suck any less. Now at 4K, it's dipped substantially, although I do think that, again, it is still running faster at 4K than the 3050 was running at 1080p. Oh, I just noticed the power draw that it's gone over 450 watts. That is by a reasonable amount the highest power draw figure I've ever seen from a GPU. Obscene power draw aside, let's see how the benchmarks stack up. Now, the most interesting part about these benchmarks for me is that in every single game I tested, the 3090 Ti's 4K results are faster than the 3050's 1080p results. In fact, when it comes to Battlefield 5 at 4K, even Big Daddy's 1% lows are higher than the little Berber's average at 1080p. Which got me thinking, what happens if we add ray tracing on top of 4K for the 3090 Ti and see how it compares to non-ray traced 1080p on the 3050? Okay, so now I have high ray tracing settings on at 4K, and we're getting what seems like a very similar experience to what we were getting at 1080p non-ray tracing with the RTX 3050. It's a bit slower, it's not as fast. There is a pretty big performance hit, if I'm honest. So when all's said and done, if you own the baby of the RTX range and you want to know what it feels like to game like an oil baron, then just pretend like you're gaming at 4K, not 1080p. That's basically the same experience, just a little bit blurrier. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, consider watching another one. A suggestion will pop up in a second. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel. I've heard it reduces your chance of getting a urinary tract infection by 23%. And considering that it's free to do, that sounds like a hell of a deal to me. And yeah, until the next video, bye-bye.